Good morning, how are y'all doing?
Good.
Good. Awesome. So, thank you, Jordan, for the introduction. I am a KU grad and have a sports management degree, so it's pretty cool to be here and to speak to a group of students where I was once sitting in your chair. So, Jordan asked me to come speak here, and I kind of had to tweet it out. A little nervous. Not always most politically correct, so in case I let it fly, he's well aware that I kind of just say what's on my mind, but it sounds like Mr. Priscilla did the same the other day, so hopefully I won't go that crazy. So today's discussion, I'll show you what we're going to talk about here shortly, but it's a discussion, guys, so got a question, raise your hand. Happy to talk about anything and everything. If something you see on here doesn't make sense, or you don't recognize a company or a function, whatever, just ask. Let's talk. I don't want to be up here yapping all day. So what I have in the deck, which again, we can use to lead the discussion, I'll give an introduction to myself, talk a little bit about the sports business, some just general career things to know, which are certainly applicable in sports, but could be for whatever you decide to do as a career, some resources within the sports industry, and then at the end, we'll just open it up and whatever you guys want to chat about. Sound fair?
Yes, good. Cool.
All right, so introduction. So you've had Fran Priscilla, you've had somebody from the Speedway, you got somebody from the Royals. What the hell is the alumni guy doing here? What does this have to do with sports management? So my current role is I am with the Alumni Association. I'm the Assistant Vice President of Alumni and Career Programs. So when you guys graduate, you're going to move across the country. So anywhere you land, we have a network. So if you're a San Diego Jayhawk, a Seattle Jayhawk, a Boston Jayhawk, New York, we have volunteers in all of those places that are putting on events and keeping you connected. So if you graduate and you're like, hey guys, I'm moving to New York, what the heck do I do? They have a Facebook page. You can go on there, like, where do I live? I got this great job in this industry. And we have people up there who help you out, let you land. If you're a KU basketball fan, well, here's my New York guy. I should have used you as the example. If you're a KU basketball fan, you're moving to Boston. You know, I want to watch the game. There's a bar somewhere in Boston with 20 Jayhawks watching the game. So great way to connect, make friends, help you personally and professionally. So that is my role that I actually get paid for some reason. Having a great time, but as Jordan mentioned, get to fly around and connect with Jayhawks across the country. However, my background is in sports and entertainment. So I'll take you through that. I'm from Derby Panthers originally. Any Derby Panthers in the room? Anyone from Wichita? Got a couple. All right, cool. So, just like you guys, grew up Wichita area, moved here, was sitting in this room several years back. Came to KU, started kind of the journalism side, and then saw the sports management program. Knew I wanted to work in and around sports. It's always been a passion of mine. So, again, was sitting in your chair a few years back. Stayed here at KU for grad school, attended the University of Kansas Law School. Was looking at a career in sports and, you know, what I wanted to do with that next level, you know, whether it's jumping right into work, or, you know, getting a master's, MBA, that kind of thing. At that time, I was seeing a lot of professionals in the sports industry that have law degrees, whether you're looking at somebody like Theo Epstein, who's now with the Cubs, a number of folks that actually worked with KU Athletics that had law degrees as well. So looked into that, thought it was the right path, and pursued it. Throughout that time, the end of my sports management and law school, was working at KU Athletics. Sent a note over, ended up working in the marketing department throughout the end of undergrad and grad school. You know, basic intern, entry-level stuff, right? Roll t-shirts, you know, run music at baseball games, run the game day giveaway program. Anything, everything. I was out there shooting t-shirts before we taught the cheerleaders how to shoot the t-shirt cannon at one point. So just very entry-level stuff. You know, get your foot in the door, get to meet a lot of people. First professional job after school, I went down to Rice University, and I was director of marketing at Rice down in Houston. So took that job. In Houston, Texas, smaller school, Houston, Texas. Knew I had the opportunity to meet a lot of people in a major city that worked in the industry. A couple fun facts here. What was really exciting about Rice University being a smaller, private, top-notch university, everyone in the athletic department that at that point was pretty new, and it's a bunch of very young, dynamic people that I thought would be great to get in with. So our athletic director at the time, Chris Delcani, is actually now the athletic director at TCU. And has done a really nice job there and is really well thought of within the college industry. Our number two is actually the AD at Miami of Ohio now. A couple of fun ones are wide receiver coach. Anyone know who our wide receiver coach at Rice in this time would be? David Beatty. So Coach Beatty was in his second year when I got there as a college coach. Our offensive coordinator was Tom Herman, who just took a little job at a small school called the University of Texas as head football coach. And our pitching coach is a gentleman named David Pierce, who is actually head baseball coach at Texas as well now. So really fun, young, exciting group, and take on an athletic department that probably needed some changes, and we had a great time there. And when you're young in your career and full of ideas, it was great to be able to jump in and implement a lot of those. Stayed at Rice the next 3 years, but slid over to IMG. Does anyone know what IMG is? Cool. All right, so now the company's a lot bigger now. A company called WME has purchased them. So at this point, this huge conglomerate, they actually own the UFC now, as well as a huge college division and plenty of information. We can talk about that later. I was on the college side. IMG in the college space serves a couple of functions. On the licensing side, they own a company called CLC. So if anyone is wearing any college gear, pretty much CCKU, if you go to the bookstore and buy a hat or whatever, you'll see a little hologram on that. That means it's officially licensed. So they have that from a licensing function. I worked on the sponsorship team. I was at Rice University. That was my property. So if you guys, and Kansas is actually an IMG school as well. So any game you go to here at the University of Kansas, you're going to see a Gatorade sign or what's the smile cam at the basketball games. Any of those things that you see that are branded or sponsored. IMG is actually, for a number of schools, they're the ones actually selling it. Okay, so the University of Kansas and Texas and Tennessee, they're not selling their sponsorships. They hire IMG to go do that for them. So served that function at Rice, got to sell sponsorships for Rice University Athletics as well as help fulfill them. So that really opened my eyes to the sponsorship realm, whereas I've been on the marketing side helping to promote events like, hey, come to our football game, come to our baseball game. Jumped on the other side where I was working with clients on the brand side. So did that for 3 years. Had the opportunity then to go to another agency called GMR Marketing. And I can talk a little bit more about GMR later, but major sports marketing, sports and entertainment marketing agency. I was on the Miller Coors team. So Miller Coors was my client. If you're not familiar with them, Miller Lite, Coors Lite, Blue Moon, Light and Googles, 100 plus beer brands. And my main function was Miller Coors, like a lot of companies, has sports sponsorships and sports partners. So I was responsible for their partnerships with the Houston Texans, with Houston Rodeo, University of Texas, University of Houston, South by Southwest, and then a bunch of other smaller deals that they had. So if you like beer and sports, probably the best job I'll ever have. It was an absolute blast being at every game for various sports and getting to meet a lot of people and promote some beer brands. It's a really fun industry. So did that for a couple years. Jumped over to the marketing arm. Looks like I didn't get one of my pictures. All right, so jumped over to another agency called the marketing arm, similar to GMR. My client this time is AT&T, and served a couple functions there, but very similar. Managed AT&T sponsorships within the sports and entertainment world. When I started there, we were more regional based, so their partnerships with professionally from like the Bulls, the Blackhawks, the Rangers. I had South by Southwest, which is what this picture is from. Finished up there managing AT&T's partnerships in the college sports realm. So across the country, AT&T has about 30 collegiate partnerships. So I think one of the pictures in this might have been a little better description of that.
Alright. So I'm going to show a quick video. This is another program we did with AT&T in the college sports world.
Hello, Priscilla, this is your Uber driver.
Hello, girl.
Hi.
Oh, my goodness.
Don't mind if we have
drop ass with
the
city. Hello.
How you doing, guys? Yeah, I'm here.
Wow.
Hey, what's up, man? Hey, this is incredible. How's it going, man? I'm Jerome Best, and we're taking college football everywhere. Let's roll.
So
So we decked out 10 of these SUVs to promote ATTUverse and set them on the network in various cities.
Man, come on, get it. You ready to watch the college football?
Oh, my God.
We'll get you out of the rain. We'll get out of the rain. Oh, of course it's going to go. This is pretty big read, right?
Yeah.
But you're a pretty big guy. And
when Andrew wins today, it's going to be the
biggest up. Yes, let's go. I want a defense.
All right, I got offense. Let's go. Loser puts the yellow mouth guard in.
Oh, he needs defense. Defense. Oh, maybe now I can shut you up.
It's wrong, bet is the truth.
Okay, so that was a pretty fun program that we ran. So when you're looking at these sponsorships, you know, what you guys are seeing as fans now, you go to a Kansas game and you're seeing signage and maybe you see the video board feature. Some of the other things you might not see is, you know, tickets, hospitality are usually part of these deals. So you have the opportunity as a company to take care of your best sales people or take care of customers, whether it's a sweepstakes or promotion. So this is called activating the partnership. You have a contract, here's all the assets you get, but what are the other things outside of that you can do to really amplify that you have a partnership? And this activation, this video, showcases how AT&T, you know, really highlight, hey, we're in the college game, we're doing really cool things in the college space. So on the ground, like, you know, about 80 people actually got a ride, and we spent, you know, 7 figures to do this program. But the real benefit of a program like that is it's on YouTube, it's on Twitter. All of the celebrities we have were tweeting about it. So, you know, you're looking at a program that's, at the end of the day, getting over 20 million impressions. And, you know, people are looking at that like, oh, well, that's cool. AT&T's, you know, working with Uber, and they're taking people to games. And it makes sort of some fun content. So, nothing.
Just playing solo
now. Oh, I lost all my pictures. I have my computer, do you think? Or is that too much of a headache? Is the thing still plugged in? So. All right, so we'll just end with that from that standpoint. Okay, so that was my career. Now I'm at the University of Kansas, so I had an opportunity. When I was in Dallas and living in Houston, I helped run our networks that I talked about. So I helped run the Houston Jayhawks and helped run the Dallas Jayhawks. So had a lot of fun doing it, getting to meet a lot of Jayhawks and, yeah, helping them through, whether it's career or just moving to a town, what do I need to do, who do I need to connect with. So that was, found that as a real passion, so I had the opportunity to come back here, and it's really helped develop that group nationwide. So that's been really exciting move for me. So any questions about the career before I kind of jump into some other pieces? Kind of everywhere, right? All right, cool. So I was gonna next share some opportunities within the sports world, like what are the positions out there that, you know, you can look forward to. I might have said it earlier when I was sitting in this room. Yeah, I was like, I'm gonna be the general manager of the Boston Red Sox, and nothing's getting in my way. And, you know, you're thinking I'm gonna work for a team, and that was about it. So there's kind of a number of different segments, and I've shown you a couple of them that I actually went through. So from the team side, you know, you can look at it like there's professional sports and there's college sports. Similar functions in both, but they operate a little differently. So if you want to go work for the Houston Rockets or the Kansas City Royals, you're working at really a small business in a lot of ways. Your office is not that many employees. You serve an owner, and, you know, you may look at that job like, wow, this is really sexy. I'm in professional sports, and there's plenty of cool opportunities to see kind of the glamour side of it. But, you know, these can be apples to oranges as far as what your experience as an employee is, right? And that depends, just like any other job, on who's your ownership, who are you reporting to, who's running these things. So, you know, if you do look to go into the team side, especially professional, think about that when you're looking at positions. Yeah, who are you working for? What kind of organization is this? Some organizations do a great job of taking care of their employees, and some don't, just like you're working in any other field outside of sports. But with sports, the glamour gets up there a little bit, and you can get a little wide-eyed and not look into it like you would another job. On the college side, things can be a little more complex in some ways. Obviously, a lot of functions within college athletics. You could be in marketing or media relations. You could be in operations. You know, you can be a trainer. So breadth of total different side with so many more sports. College sports, like professional sports, are, you know, trying to make money, but it's a little different game because you're part of a university and, you know, you do report up to a chancellor, and the decisions you make are not always the decisions you would make if you were running a business. So you hear probably fairly often, oh, college sports is a business, just like any, yeah, they're trying to make money, but if they're serving a different purpose and serving a different mission, so it's not exactly apples to apples with professional and college. So even though you can pretty easily hop from a marketing person at a college to a marketing person to professional, you need to kind of think, how do I fit within these organizations, and is it what I believe in and what I want to do, because you're serving a different master. Agency side, there's a couple of sides of that business too. I showed you two agencies on the brand side. So, you know, I worked for a couple agencies that represented brands. Brands hired us to manage their partnerships. You're probably a little more familiar with player agents, right? Jerry Maguire, that kind of scene. So that's another side of it. That's a little more of what's better known of, you know, hey, I can negotiate your contract and find marketing deals for you and take care of your players. You know, you can do something like James Harden, for example, has a big Verizon deal, a huge Adidas deal. And then obviously his contract with the Rockets. So there's an agency that manages all of those aspects for him. The brand side similar, except you're working, you know, you're representing a brand and working with teams to help get them out there. And then finally, vendors. There's plenty of other opportunities in the sports space. And the reason I'm telling you guys this is because, when I was sitting in this chair, I was like, you know, Red Sox, Yankees, you know, I'm just looking at teams. I didn't realize, you know, how big this industry was. But even from a vendor side, I mean, a company like BDA is, you know, the company working with teams and brands to make bobbleheads and 800 different types of apparel items. So there's a lot of opportunities within that field of people who do work in and around sports that, you know, names you would never see in a paper or ever hear about. You can actually work directly for the brands. A company like Dr. Pepper has a sponsorship team, and, you know, they don't go hire an agency to manage their partnerships. It's something they take care of in-house. Adidas has a really cool team out in Portland that, you know, works with all of their various functions. So whether it's, you know, their golf business or their basketball business, whether it's professional or college or working with their athletes, a lot of cool opportunities there. So those are some other functions in there. A couple other things I wanted to touch on. Networking, like any business, is huge. The sports industry is surprisingly very, very small. And one of the slides I was hoping to show you guys, I was sitting in Austin putting this deck together with one of my other current coworkers and alumni, who we worked together in athletics back in the day. And we challenged each other, let's come up with a list of teams and places that people worked at just from our small group at the University of Kansas. I'm just going to use it to illustrate, you know, how small the sports industry was. And we looked just within our small circle of friends from our few years working at Kansas Athletics, and I had three columns of businesses and sports, whether it's college or professional, that people we knew had gone to work for, whether, you know, from the Royals to the Padres to University of Florida, Ohio State, I mean, literally everything, and we didn't even put any time into it. So the point I'm trying to make there is you can be a great networker and it'll pay off, but you could frankly just be hanging out at the University of Kansas and not even try that hard, and where your network would be a few years later is just, it's absurd. It's coast to coast. So, you know, networking, you know, you always hear that it's not what you know, it's who you know. That absolutely plays in the sports business. Anytime I've applied for a job in sports, you know, you have your references. My references never get called. They go right to your LinkedIn page, and who do they know that you know, and that person gets a call within seconds. You know, something to think about as you're moving forward in careers. Reputation is absolutely huge. I imagine you guys, I grew up in a little different era where, you know, my entire life wasn't documented online until a certain age. It's unbelievable. And the illustration I had to show this, the Texas Rangers Twitter a couple years back, the University of Texas football was losing a game, and the Texas Rangers Twitter plays out, "Fire Charlie," referring to Charlie Strong, the head football coach. Okay, a little bizarre that the Texas Rangers Twitter would do that, right? So obviously, clear mistake, it was deleted minutes later. So about 6 months later, I'm interviewing a guy for a coordinator position.
really sharp guy, and I didn't from his resume, I didn't expect him to really wow me. I had some better candidates, but I was like, he was an internal kid, so I took the meeting. I go through it, and I was like, oh, he was all right. And so, you know, I asked a couple colleagues, what was the deal? He actually surprised me, you know, think he might be in the running. And a colleague tells me, well, he's the kid that got fired for Fire Charlie. He got, you know, might have had a couple drinks and was posting on his Twitter account. Whoops, it was a Texas Rangers Twitter account and not his. So something like that can sink you. So again, it's a small industry. So, you know, network, you know, keep your head down, do a great job, but also be really careful because the smallest things can hit you toast to toast. So that's one other thing I want to touch on. As far as industry resources, you know, if you are interested in the sports business, you know, sports business journals, great way to keep up what's going on in the business. You know, and it's everything from college to NASCAR to golf. It's, you know, all about those kind of things. If you go on Twitter, plenty of good resources you can find, whether it's not just the teams, but, you know, people who write for Sports Business Journal. I'm not going to say Aaron Revelle because his stuff drives me nuts. But a lot of really interesting places out there that you can track. I'm going to give you guys all my contact info, too. If you are interested in working in sports, I'm happy to take as many meet for coffee and talk through, you know, what you're trying to do and how we can help out. There's a Jayhawk almost everywhere, so when you guys do get to that point in your career, if you are looking to dive into this industry, I always say find the Jayhawk. They're always really helpful, and I know when I was sitting in these chairs, I would have been probably too intimidated to reach out, and probably a little too cocky too. I'll figure it out. I got this. But man, I wish I had known at that time just how helpful our people are to each other, especially our students coming up. So just a little bit of advice there. What questions did you guys have? How's it going? What's your name?
You think that dude that got fired for making the tweet, you're going to get another big position like that?
So he needs to kind of rehabilitate. He was working for an agency, so he got him there. And he'll work his way. If he does a good job, he'll work his way up. But, you know, that's something that's always going to sit there. You know, that doesn't go away. And if, you know, somebody talks to somebody, he may find a job or he may interview with somebody that they don't know that he was behind that. Or, you know, and time heals all wounds too. So you get a little further away from it. If you have a good amount of good work to show for yourself and people speak well for you, you'll do fine. But when you're still this close to that kind of incident, you know, people are going to be hesitant to hire somebody who made a mistake that, at the end of the day, not that big a deal, right? Charlie did get fired, so it's not that big of a deal, but it makes national news, and it makes a lot of people that you work for have to deal with stuff, and that's, you know, kind of what it comes down to. So it's bad press. So, very good question. Hi, what's your name?
I'm Angie. How important do you think a law degree was?
That's a really good question. I could have done every single job I've had in my career without a law degree. I don't know that I would have gotten every job I've had in my career without a law degree. It's part of your resume, it's part of your story. And I've missed out on opportunities because I've had a law degree. I've gone into interviews and they've looked at it and been like, a sports job, you know, that's paying $30,000 a year, and I come in with, and they see a law degree, and I've gotten dismissed. Like, right away, like, well, you went to law school, I'm not dealing with that. So, overall, I think it's absolutely not. It's gotten me in a lot of doors. The networking within law school is really strong, especially here. So, I can't tell you how many times I've been in conversations with somebody, and they introduce me and say, oh, he has a law degree. So, it sounds weird, but it helps. So, it's helped a lot from the networking standpoint. From a career standpoint, what really helped about it, I got to spend 3 more years here. So I did KU Athletics, like, you know, 1 in a million. I worked at KU Athletics for a semester. I worked there for 4 years. So it really helped me develop, you know, my skills, my experiences, and even my network within KU Athletics. So it helped a lot from that standpoint. From a knowledge standpoint, you know, if something legal comes up to me, I'm finding a lawyer, an actual lawyer, to go deal with it. But it helps from an issue spotting standpoint, right? Because you go through law school, it's like,
something that you may just see that could have been an issue that you may just run over. Like I'm saying, okay, wait, we need to talk about this, we need to get to a lawyer. Or so I know enough to be dangerous, but the best part is you know, knowing that I shouldn't be dealing with them. So, good question. Are you thinking about law school?
I'm trying to decide between law school and business.
Cool. You can do both. I mean, KU has a joint MBA and law degree program at least 4 years. Yeah, let me know. And if you want to talk offline, I'm happy to meet with you and talk through it. So, what else? Anything? Sports industry, career-wise. Anyone want to work in sports? Raise your hand if you're looking at working in sports. Okay, so all of you. All right. So you got like what 40 minutes with me? Let's go. Hi. What's your name?
Chris.
Hi, Chris.
What was the competitive?
The competitiveness is primarily on the field, right? Not behind the scenes. And within certain markets, you'd see it. Okay, so selling sponsorships. I'm selling sponsorships for Rice University to the same people that University of Texas, Houston Astros, Houston Rockets, University of Houston, Houston Rodeo, and whatever other minor league team. So we're dealing with the same people, and you know, budgets are limited. So yeah, there's some competitiveness there. As far as getting to know people and networking, not at all, because everyone has been somewhere else. So, and that's a really good question because it lets me go on a point that I wasn't going to bring up. I went to Houston, Texas because it's a major city and I knew I can get an opportunity to meet a lot of people. And I was like, okay, I'll go to Rise, do a year there. I'll meet people with the Texans, with the Rockets, with the Astros. We'll, you know, have some opportunities. So getting down there, within about 6 months, I hired a young lady to work on my team who went to Kansas State. Had another gentleman at what was then Reliant Stadium, now NRG Stadium, went to KU, and then met another guy who worked for the Rockets, became a friend. So four of us started looking at each other like, man, we got this cool thing here, and you guys, why don't we throw a happy hour? Like, let's get some people involved. So we pulled together everyone we knew, and even people we didn't know, and we're like, we're throwing a happy hour. We sent the invite to everyone in sports across Houston. And so we started the Houston Sports Entertainment Networking Group. And it was a success. We had like 65 people show up at the first one, and it was the Astros, and it was the Rockets and the Texans, and it ranged from ticket sales to, you know, player office to trainer, so across all of the different functions. And I mean, we're talking 9 years later, I'm looking at that group, and I'm still friends with a huge chunk of them, and they're working from, you know, the Mariners to the Eagles to Boston College, I mean, across the country now. You know, a couple of my friends that showed up to that, you know, at the time they were quality control guys at Houston Texans. They had $30,000 a year or whatever. It was the lowest guy on the Houston Texans coaching staff. Okay, well, one of them just got hired as the 49ers defensive coordinator. Another one just got hired as the LA Rams offensive coordinator. And yeah, these were guys that, you know, we were slinging beers, hanging out with a couple, you know, 25-year-olds back in the day. So, people are generally really good about networking because, you know, we're all trying to climb. And you know, if you can build a good crew and a good network, people take care of each other. So, we're competitive. We're taking the same dollars, but it's in a fun way. Because at the end of the day, it's a small business. We may be fighting each other today, but we're not going to be tomorrow. One other illustration of that, when I was at Rice University. Rice and the University of Houston are about 3 miles. Does anyone know Houston? Is anyone from there? All right, so you know what I'm talking about. Houston and Rice are about 3 miles apart from each other. For a while, they were in the same conference. There's a little less competitiveness now that they aren't right now. Okay, so we were looking at that. We didn't have a branded deal. If you look at OU Texas football, it's the AT&T Red River Showdown. All right, well, I can probably find some dollars if I can find somebody to get excited about Rice in Houston. So I go chase State Farm down because they were interested in it. Got State Farm to do that deal. And the client at State Farm that I worked with, really good guy. We got along well. Treated each other with respect. Things worked out well. 2 years later, I'm at GMR representing Miller Coors. He's at the Formula One racetrack, Circuit of the Americas in Austin, Texas. He's trying to sell to me. He wants my Miller Coors partnership. So when you've been around business, you know that, you know, these things are going to change. So, you know, it's just maintaining that reputation because you never know. I mean, you may be chasing somebody down one day and they're chasing you down another. So,
Where in Houston are you from?
Pearland.
Pearland?
Love it.
Let's do one more question for Nick.
Hi, what's your name?
Jamil.
Nice to meet you.
All right, my question is, so I'm kind of approaching it differently. I know a lot of people are going for like a sportsman major.
Yeah.
In, like, business major. Sure. Online. But I'm doing the business major in marketing, and then I'm going to do like the sports management minor.
Yeah.
I feel like, I don't know if that's going to make like a difference when I try to approach the sports industry.
Yeah.
Yeah,
and, you know, different people may give different answers. So if you didn't hear the question, it was, you know, if I do sports management major and a business minor, a business major and a sports management minor, like, you may have a different answer. You can get into sports in a variety of ways. Your degree is part of that. It tells a story. But what else are you doing? So, I mean, you can come at me with a business major and sports management minor, but, you know, did you work at KU Athletics? Did you intern? Like, what are these other things you're doing? When Jordan and I first met, we were talking about, there are so many Jayhawks and sports guys in the sports industry, and he has done an incredible job of getting a database together of all of those folks. And the database at the time was primarily Jayhawks and sports that, you know, went through sports management. And, you know, we were talking, and it was like, man, you know, this doesn't account for all the business grads, this doesn't count, there's a ton of journalism grads out there in the sports industry, too, that are Jayhawks. So I don't think it really matters. You know, get your degree. And, you know, what else are you doing? So when I've been looking at hiring entry-level people, you know, you're looking at that full story, and, you know, I really typically wanted to see that you did something outside of just school. Like, if it's just school, like, there's not a lot, that doesn't tell me a big story. Like, a lot of people did just school. So I would always look like, you know, did you do an internship with somebody? What also really helped, did someone call me? A lot of times, you know, I think student athletes is one area where it's really tough to do an internship in that kind of scene. But I would have, you know, a coach or somebody I know or somebody who worked on staff call me and be like, hey, take a look at this person, you know, get him an interview. And you know, if you're the best candidate, you're the best candidate. So.
All right, thanks, Nick.